14 black children and 2 white children that attended that school. And within a year, there were more children wanting to go to Reverend King's school now, because the education that he was teaching was called a classical education.
Mm-hmm.
So everything, the basics, arithmetic, geography, English, plus Greek, Latin, and a Christian-based education. And now some of the whites who were opposed to this settlement being formed now were seeking permission from Reverend King to have their children attend this school where the quality of education is being taught. So, you know, it's okay for Mary to go to school with a black child now and to be taught by a black teacher.
Buxton is located 45 minutes east of Windsor, Canada, and 3 hours from Toronto. The area's close proximity to the Canadian-U.S. border was convenient for fugitive slaves, but it also remained accessible to slave catchers.
Buxton, I guess because when the fugitive slave law was passed in the United States in 1850, even though slave catchers were not allowed to come into Canada, the settlements along the Detroit River, they were, you know, very accessible to slave catchers, Windsor and Detroit and Niagara and Buffalo. So they were risking a lot by coming this far north.
Now, when Buxton was founded, how many people settled the community at first?
There was sort of a gradual influx of people. Within a couple of years, there were 200 families. By 1857, I think there were 300 families. And the population got to be about 1,200 people by the time the Civil War began. But we spoke about the 9,000 acres that formed the settlement, but actually the area immediately surrounding the settlement was also predominantly black. So there was probably closer to, well over 5,000 acres settled by black families who thought of Buxton as their center. They went to school there. They went to church there. They were part of that whole social community.
Shannon, when you were talking about Reverend King, and we got a real sense of what kind of man he was, but he also imposed some pretty strict standards on those who came. What was behind these rules?
Number one, when they arrived here, they had to deal with the concept of being free, number one, because they had been enslaved probably most of their lives, and now suddenly they were free. That term to them did not really mean anything until they realized that, yes, you do, you know, own yourself. You own your property, you own your land, and now, you're working for yourself. So there was some structure there for them. But also the fact that because there was that opposition in the beginning, Reverend King basically wanted to dispel those myths in the outlying area that blacks were lazy, uneducated, and dirty. And yes, they could become self-sufficient and self-sustaining. And those rules were established to say, yes, they can do this. And it was touted as one of the most successful settlements in Canada West at the time. And the rules, they adhered to them very well, like the flower garden. You know, there were competitions throughout the settlement to see who had the best flower garden. And there was a strong sense of community as well that was instilled in everyone. So when you arrived, everyone received those 50 acres, and you were charged $2.50 an acre, mm-hmm. and you had within 10 years to pay that off.
You're listening to World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick, and we're talking to Buxton, Ontario residents and historians Brian and Shannon Prince about the planned settlement of Buxton, Ontario, Canada's role in the Underground Railroad, and the country's own history with slavery.
There was indeed slavery here in Canada, and it did not end until Britain abolished it throughout its empire in 1834. So just sort of as an aside, there are interesting stories about slaves here in Canada escaping over to Michigan and Ohio, the Northwest territory of the U.S., because in theory there was no slavery there. So you have that sort of reverse Underground Railroad, slaves mm-hmm. escaping from Canada to the United States. But after 1834 especially, Canada was viewed as the place where blacks could come and truly be free. And we're learning more and more all the time about how widespread the Underground Railroad network was. And some of the stories are familiar to a lot of your listeners, William Still in particular in Philadelphia and his network. But there were certainly networks in New York, Ohio, Washington, D.C., Indiana, Michigan, Illinois. And they are very much connected with a sort of a handful of anti-slavery activists here in Canada. And it's very interesting as you scan the old newspapers of the day, the minutes of the anti-slavery societies, and individual letters and diaries that survive. It's interesting to see how closely connected those agents, those abolitionists, were in Canada and in the United States.
There were two fugitive slave laws, but the one that passed in 1850 struck terror throughout the black community because it incentivized slave catchers and the judicial system to return freed black slaves to slavery.
There actually was the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793, but as time went on, it wasn't quite as strictly enforced, and it didn't have the teeth in it that the 1850 Fugitive Slave Law had. When that was passed, there was a terror that sort of flowed throughout the northern states. Blacks who had perhaps been free for generations were not safe. They were, you'll often read stories of them being kidnapped and sent into slavery. And then, of course, there were a great many who were fugitive slaves, who had fled, some lived a year or two or ten in the northern states. And the teeth of the law demanded that the regular citizen be a part of capturing runaway slaves. There were fines and threatened jail sentences for interfering with the capture of runaways. There were incentives for judges to rule that a black brought before them was indeed a runaway slave. The judge would get $10 if he ruled it was a runaway. Mm-hmm. He would get $5 if he ruled the person was free. And to make matters worse, blacks were not allowed to testify on their own behalf. So there is this shudder that goes throughout the black communities in the North, and a flood begins.
Brian, coming back to the institution of slavery in Canada, was slavery different in Canada versus the American South, or even in parts of the United States such as Missouri?
Well, I think it was very different from what most of us think of as slavery in the South. I think it perhaps more closely parallels when there was slavery in the northern states. Here there weren't the huge plantations that needed a big labor force. People often would have two or three slaves, perhaps a smaller family. They were in a little bit closer proximity, working in the house and in the barns and in the surrounding smaller farm, which is much different than the large cotton and sugarcane plantations that we think of in the South. So there were attachments. But that's one of the most interesting things I find when I'm researching, and you see the interviews that were done with slaves, with former slaves, and it's quite incredible to me how often they will say how I miss the master, or I miss the mistress.
Yeah.
I had an attachment to their children, and I would like to go back. And so there's that strange contradiction of the fear, the terror, the things we all think about in slavery, but then just those human attachments, quite something.
For more information on the Buxton Historical Site and Museum, visit this show page at worldfootprints.com.
You know, there are a lot of
paths along the Underground Railroad. The path that we took today in today's show is just one of many from people traveling to the north from the south. But even with this limited pathway from Virginia through Pennsylvania, New York, and Ontario, we uncovered a ton of stories that we never heard about before. And that begs the question, you know, how many more other stories are out there? There's just a lot of surprising stories that we've heard today.
And one of the most surprising ones was to start our Underground Railroad tour in Norfolk, Virginia. And a lot of people don't really think of the South as being pertinent to the Underground Railroad, but this trail that Dr. Cassandra Newby-Alexander at Norfolk State has helped to bring to life in Norfolk really layers a different story on the Underground Railroad, and we kind of learned what a border city that was in the South actually was more free and open than places like Maryland and other parts of Virginia and certainly other parts of the South in terms of providing a safe haven to blacks who were trying to make it north.
Yeah, and you know, I must say I was very, very surprised to hear about an Underground Railroad in Virginia because, like everyone else, like yourself, Virginia is the South. It is below the Mason-Dixon line, and so it was very surprising to hear that there was a coalition of Quakers who even helped Kitty Payne, the first black person, African-American woman, to actually be heard in court. I mean, that's unprecedented, you know, that she found that in Virginia. And that's one of many favorite stories that we uncovered on today's show, especially as a lawyer, as lawyers, that resonated with me.
Yeah, and certainly in the case of Kitty Payne, she was in Pennsylvania, and they came to Pennsylvania. Her nephew of the former owner brought her back to Virginia, basically as if she's chattel and she had been properly manumitted. And so it just points out that even being in the North, being above the Mason-Dixon line, didn't necessarily guarantee freedom, even if you had the legal papers to declare that you were a free person.
Well, that was a result of the Fugitive Slave Act, which we talked about in the show, and it really just empowered judicial persons and law enforcement to declare that even freed people were slaves because they were compensated for those lies. Another one of my favorite stories that we shared also came out of our Gettysburg journey, and that was a story of James Pennington, who happened upon the kindness of two strangers, a Quaker family, who happened to teach him to read and write. You know, he was illiterate, and he spent 6 months with him, I understand, and that act of kindness actually allowed him to go to Yale Divinity School and become a Presbyterian minister. And fast forward a few years, he ended up marrying Frederick Douglass to his wife. And that is just a wonderful example of the type of positive ripple an act of kindness can have on a person's life. So on that beautiful note, in closing, consider this thought. In recognizing the humanity of our fellow beings, we pay ourselves the highest tribute. Thurgood Marshall. As always, it's a pleasure to spend this time with you, and we thank you so much for inviting us into your life. We're Tanya and Ian Fitzpatrick, and we look forward to sharing another amazing journey with you on World Footprints Radio.
World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick is a production of World Footprints Media, Silver Spring, Maryland. The multi-award-winning radio show can be heard around the globe on iHeartRadio, Stitcher, iTunes, and more. Visit worldfootprints.com for a complete list. World Footprints Radio is a leading voice in socially responsible travel. At worldfootprints.com, you'll find an archive of past broadcasts, travel news, reviews, and information you can use to deepen your travel experience. Listen, learn, and live it at worldfootprints.com.